morning. It's very nice to meet with all of you. And I'm a vegan recruit. I spent most of my training in early career in Los Angeles. I'm just really excited to join the melanoma fighting community here to help patients who have the lung areas. So the topic today for me is actually pretty complicated, two very complicated topics. How does immunotherapy work and how to manage the symptoms? So I will spend the 15 minutes to just to cover the basic principle. And if you have questions, you can ask questions in the end. These are my disclosures. I'm a consultant for the industry, and I get research support from several of the industry companies. So like what Sam and Dr. Bowman mentioned, so in the past 10 years, we really had a major breakthrough in the treatment management of the melanoma patients. You can see 10 years ago, the two-year survival for melanoma patients in stage 4 is 10 to 15%. If we treat some patients, only one or two of them would survive more than a two-year mark. And fast forward 10 years later, now we're looking at 6 to 7 of those patients who still survive out of 10 patients we treat. And the major reason for this improvement is because of the development of immunotherapy. So how does immunotherapy work? So in all of us, and every patient, or in all of us, there is an dendritic cell actually going around our body and pick up debris from normal cells and the tumor cells. And they would carry these debris of the cells, the dead cells, to the lymph nodes and present these cells to the leading T cells, which is the soldier cells, the fighting cells for you to fight the cancer or any foreign pathogen. However, once this signal is transmitted to the T cell, in response, the T cell would express something called CTLA-4. That's a checkpoint cell to this immune response. And that's a natural response we all have to stop an unnecessary autoimmune response. So, however, it can also stop an anti-tumor response. And now we develop antibodies to bind to CTLA-4 and replace the CTLA-4 from the from this interaction, and then allow the T cell to be activated and go out and look for the tumor cells and kill the tumor cells. So that is ipilimumab. Some of you have already been exposed to this drug. And clearly, when we look at the tumors of the patients who are treated with ipilimumab or SSTI4, you can see after the treatment, the patient's tumor have more T cells in their tumor, and that's regardless of whether they are longer or not. It just shows the mechanism of anti-CTLA-4, including T cells, the soldier cells, to the tumor. And also, it can broaden the repertoire of T cells, the increasing possibility that you would have a T cell that can kill the cancer. So that's why ipilimumab is approved for treatment of melanoma. But if you look at the survival of the patient, actually only a very small portion of patients can benefit from this treatment. And we later figure out that there is actually another mechanism that can stop the T cell from working. So all the activated T cells express something called CD1. So it's an activation marker or a exhaustion marker of the T cell. And once the T cell is activated, it releases interferon gamma to kill the tumor cell. And the tumor cell sends the sender signal, the interferon gamma, and immediately it expresses PD-L1 on the surface to stop this T cell attack. And that's the checkpoint, PD-1 checkpoint, that stops the T cell from working. And not only do we have antibodies to stop the to block the PD-1 or PD-L1 ligand. And in melanoma, we use anti-PD-1, that's nivolumab or Keytruda, pembrolizumab, to block this checkpoint so that the T cell can continue to kill the cancer cells. So with that development, now if we treat 10 patients with anti-PD-1, 40 of them can respond to the therapy, and that should translate into much better survival of the patients. And the most exciting part is we now see activity of anti-PD-1 in the tumor types that are not traditionally considered immunotherapy sensitive. You can see there are several different products of anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 approved for many different indications, indicating that all the patients have all cancer patients have the potential to respond to immunotherapy. So one interesting thing about immunotherapy is there are some observations showing that the total mutational burden, how many mutations that the patient tumor has, actually can predict the response to immunotherapy. So this is the chart charting the median tumor mutational burden, number of mutations in each tumor type, and then again, the response rate of that tumor type to immunotherapy, to anti-immunotherapy. And you can see it's almost a linear regression. It's closely correlated. However, TMB, total mutational burden, is not the perfect biomarker for immunotherapy because we see patients who have very high mutational burden, yet they don't respond to anti-immune therapy. And we have seen patients with very low mutational burden, but they can respond to immunotherapy. But they tell us a trend that the more, the better. And indeed, when we look at the subgroup of melanoma patients, that's more classic melanoma patients. So this is a very rare type of melanoma that there's very strong association of UV light exposure, UV damage. With the occurrence of desmoplastic melanoma. And this is a tumor type with almost the highest tumor mutational burden of all cancers. And when we look at these patients, we have these patients who were treated with this therapy and look at their response, it's amazing. 70% of the patients responded to anti-PD-1 therapy, and then a third of this response is complete response. And then when we look at the patient's survival, all the complete responders never relapse. So that's pretty exciting. And it shows the value of total mutational burden in the response to immunotherapy. So this is an example, of a patient treated at UCLA. The patient had a desmoplastic melanoma on the skull and another one on his face. So desmoplastic melanoma tends to grow along the nerve ending. So it's very hard to get a surgical, clear surgical margin. So if the patient goes on to surgery, it would be very deforming surgery. And still, we may not get a clear margin. So we start the patient on anti-chemotherapy, and you can see several weeks later, the tumor is already shrinking, the one on the face almost disappeared, and the one on the skull completely shrunk. And several months later, the lesion is completely disappeared, even the hair broke back. So this is amazing, we're using a drug that doesn't even target the tumor, it targets the immune system, and amazingly, we can activate our immune system to kill the cancer. So now, at SWOG, which is a cooperative group that runs clinical trials under the guidance leadership of the National Cancer Institute, we actually develop a protocol to confirm this observation in desmoplastic melanoma patients. And also, we want to see whether we can get this drug actually before before surgery so that we can avoid the patient from a very long surgery and improve the outcome. And it's open at Huntsman. So now we see all this excitement, but actually when we look at patient survival and especially going out of melanoma to other tumor types, the response rate or the patient who can be helped with this treatment with checkpoint inhibitors is still a very small percentage of patients. So we want to apply the benefits to the majority of the patients. And the question is how? So one obvious option is since anti-CTLA-4 and anti-PD-1 work at different phases of PD-L1 activation, anti-CTLA-4 is in the priming phase, anti-PD-1 is in the effector phase. Now we can recombine them together and improve the patient outcome. So this is what the CheckMate 067 trial is designed for. So there are some caveats about this trial. So they actually randomized the patients to nivolumab plus ipilimumab anti-PD-1 plus anti-CTLA-4 versus anti-PD-1 by itself or versus anti-CTLA-4 by itself. But at the time of the trial activation, ipilimumab was still the standard of care treatment. So that's why the trial was designed to compare the combo versus DC or the nivolumab versus, but it was not designed to compare the anti-PD-1 versus the combination. So that's the caveat when you look at the results. But still, there are more than 300 patients on each arm. And you can see there's a significant improvement in the response rate. So if we treat 10 patients with the combination therapy, then 6 of them will respond to the therapy better than the 4 patients of the single agent anti-PD-1. But if you look at the survival of these patients, it becomes the more into the treatment, the closer actually the survival curve becomes. And on the other hand, the combination actually triggers very bad toxicity in a great percentage of patients. 60% of patients would have grade 3-4 toxicity versus only 20% or 30% with simple agents. So that this trial tells us, although, you know, keep in mind of all the caveats that I have mentioned, and also the patients on the simple agent arm and the CD1 arm can go to and get anti-CTLA-4 later on if they progress. But still, the data suggests that if we get ipilimumab later when the patient progresses on anti-PD-1, it may be just as good as giving them after on the avoid the area. So, in fact, at SWOG, we designed a trial to test this possibility. And if you have stage 4 melanoma and have already progressed on anti-PD-1, I encourage you to join this, this trial so we can learn from the experiment. So now, what about the other patient who would not respond to anti-PD-1, anti-CTLA-4, or the combination? What do we do? So in order to understand how to help those patients, first of all, we need to learn the resistance mechanism to immunotherapy, and which can be quite complex. Unlike chemotherapy or target therapy, where you know the tumor cell is the key to understand the resistance, in immunotherapy, the resistance can exist in inside of the tumor cell or outside of the tumor cell along the T cell activation process, or it can be T cell exhaustion, or it can be a very hostile tumor microenvironment that stops the T cell working. And to make it even more complicated, the resistance can develop at the baseline before the patient is treated or along their treatment, even after they get the response. So there are many different mechanisms or combination strategies are being developed to help patients overcome this resistance. So it all comes down to helping the T cells, which is the soldier fighting T cells, to eradicate the tumor cells. There are a lot of barriers in between. So there are strategies to help the T cells to recognize the tumor, to help the T cells to be primed to kill the cancer cells. There are strategies to help boost the T cell function or improve the very hostile tumor microenvironment. Or there are strategies to target other checkpoints in addition to T-cell-4 and CD1. So there are probably at least several hundred, maybe a thousand trials out there testing all these different combination strategies. So there are a lot of activity going on, and at Huntsman, The trials actually all these highlighted areas, and there are more trials opening to help patients figure out what the mechanism. So these are a few trials that we have for patient who have never been exposed to immunotherapy. There are strategies to actually use personalized cancer vaccine in combination of immunotherapy to help the immune system recognize the tumor. There are strategies to improve outcome around the surgery. And also there is a very exciting trial coming along that actually manipulates the fat microbiome to improve the efficacy of immunotherapy. And there are measures of these trials that in the refractory setting that can help patients overcome the resistance. And within the phase one program, we have all these other strategies to help patients. So now I want to switch here and talk about the toxicity to immunotherapy, which is a question that almost every patient asks me if I get this treatment, what kind of toxicity I would experience. And the answer is very, it's very hard to answer those questions because it can be anything. So our goal with immunotherapy is to mount the anti-tumor response to the cancer, but in the process, we can also activate the immune response against our own body. So with anti-PD-1, the toxicity is a little bit less severe, the spectrum is smaller because we are activating the T-cell factor base, and they already developed anti-tumor response specific to that tumor. And with anti-CTLA-4, that toxicity spectrum becomes much broader and much severe, and of course, it's even worse with the combination. So the toxicity, we call it immune-related adverse event, IRAE, can happen anytime. It can happen in any tissue. We usually consider whatever toxicity you're experiencing is immune related until someone otherwise. But we always rule out other reasons that default is always immune related adverse events. So the common ones we see with immunotherapy is fatigue, dermatitis, colitis, and chronopathy, hepatitis, pneumonitis in the sequence of less severe or less common. And there are really rare toxicities that we have seen, neurological, physiological, even if the immune response can target the heart, the muscle, the kidney. The mechanism is likely T cell mediated, just like the anti-tumor response, but it's very hard to confirm that hypothesis. Unfortunately, we don't have developed biomarkers to predict toxicity, so what I usually tell patients is we will have to treat you to know whether you will have toxicity and what kind of toxicity you will have, and then we'll manage together. And then the way we manage immune-related adverse events is by immune suppression. So with the high-dose steroids, and usually the majority of the IRAE can be treated successfully with steroids. But sometimes we have to use more intense immunosuppression. So this is just a picture to show you the spectrum of IRAE. Basically, it just tells you it can happen anywhere. And with anti-CTLA-4 and anti-PD-1, the toxicity profile is a little bit different. So with anti-CTLA-4, we see more diarrhea, we see more rash, skin toxicities, and we see more hepatitis. And with anti-CD1 therapy, we see more pneumonitis, which is more specific to pneumonitis and thyroid function, which is more commonly with anti-PD-1. And you can see with the combination that you see much more percentage of the toxicity that is associated with the level, the severity is much more with the combination therapy. And this is just a figure to show you the timing of toxicity. And that's another question I'm often asked, when did toxicity will appear? And the answer is it can appear anytime. So it can appear right away, and somehow the toxicity happen more acute than others, like the thyroid dysfunction, rash, and diarrhea can happen earlier in the first 2 to 3 months of the treatment, and then hepatitis and other renal dysfunction, all these other rare tendencies start to show up. And that there are fatal toxicities that have been associated with anti-PD-1 or the anti-PD-4 or the combination. And the cardiac toxicity has been seen as more related to the combination of these five people. And then we usually, the way we manage the toxicity is first we will grade the toxicity with this CTCAE, the common terminology for variable adverse event, that's disease of UCI. And grade 1 and grade 2 are milder toxicity, and grade 3 and 4 are severe toxicity, and of course grade 5 is death. We don't see that with all the immunotherapy. And for grade 1 or 2, we usually just monitor the patient, we hold the treatment, and whether the toxicity would go away. For grade 3 through grade 4, we usually start the immunosuppression. And usually, when we decide to do immunosuppression, we go from the high dose. We go with 1 to 2 milligrams per kilogram of steroids. And then taper later on when the symptoms improve. So the steroids have many different functions, and the main function here, the reason we use it is because it can suppress the release of cytokines and chemokines that cause the majority of these symptoms. And there are special scenarios when the patients already have autoimmune disease, and then we need to use immunotherapy. It's a very, very complicated decision whether we use immunotherapy, and the management of these patients is quite complex as well. So we usually have a very, very thorough evaluation to see whether we should start immunotherapy medication, and then monitor them along the way. And this is a summary of some patients who have pre-existing autoimmune disease that were treated with immunotherapy. And you can see their outcomes from durable complete response all the way to fatal event. So it's a very, very difficult population of patients to manage. And of course, when we use immunosuppression in these patients, so the big question is, are we going to interfere with the anti-tumor response that we are trying to induce in these patients? And there are, unfortunately, there are a lot of reports coming out showing that, number one, if the patient develops toxicity from the immunotherapy you're giving them, and then you use immunotherapy, you use immunosuppression, then it may not affect the outcome. In fact, the fact that the patient gets immune-related toxicity may be a predictor of response. So all these reports are saying there's no negative effect on the anti-tumor response And you can see, so these are survival curves of those oncology patients who get toxicity from IRAD. It seems like the patients who have IRAD have much better survival out of the other patients. And also the number of not just the severity or the existence, yes or no, IRAD, but also the number of IRAD, different IRAD they get is more, the different variety of IRAD also predicts the better survival. The more IRAD you get, the better survival you will have. And this is exactly the same survival curve of the Chinese survival trial that I mentioned before. And you can see this is the survival of the patient of the combination therapy as orange, and survival of the single agent as mentioned as green. And the brown curve is are those patients who had your IRAD, and you can see that actually we are seeing survival. So it gave us some confidence that the patient needs to feel so this is just another example. The patients who have skin toxicity, then they have better survival than the patients who don't. And out of the skin toxicity, it seems like late occurrence of skin toxicity predicts that survival. And very little out of this variety of skin toxicity. So very little is the autoimmune response against the monocytes, and patients have white skin, their skin turns white, and that seems to predict better survival. So take home message. I already mentioned it can IRAD can occur anytime and any tissue when we manage with the steroids. And for our patients out there getting immunotherapy, just to be vigilant and either report your symptoms right away, we will manage the symptoms better. So in conclusion, I probably already run out of time. So immunotherapy has the potential to provide survival benefits to majority of acute patients, but we need to figure out how to help those patients who can not function anti-tumor response by simply giving immunotherapy. And successful development of combination strategies for those patients who don't respond to stimulating anti-tumor will rely on our clear understanding of the resistant mechanisms, the heterogeneity of resistant mechanisms in the patient. And then we need to develop biomarkers to associate response to combination therapy. And also, we need to develop preventive measures to lower the iron sustained risk. So I thank you for your attention.